Hello, everyone. Welcome. My name is Bonnie Brzozowski. I'm a public services librarian at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. We're so glad you've joined our presentation tonight. It's titled Reviving the Wetlands at Finley National Wildlife Refuge. This is part of the 2023 Liz and Bob Frenkel Environment and Hiking Spring Webinar Series. The theme for this year's series is Reviving and Hiking Willamette Valley Wetlands. There are two virtual events in addition to this one that are part of the series. On Wednesday, April 19th at 7 p.m., we will talk about reviving the wetlands at Herbert Farm Natural Area. On Wednesday, May 17th at 7 p.m., we will talk about Owens Farm / Jackson Fraser Wetland Complex. Registration is necessary to attend these free virtual events. I'm going to share links to register for each one in the chat right about now. Let's see if I can do that nice and smoothly for us. And there they are. So please do register. We hope you will join us. As I'm sure you've noticed, we are using Zoom tonight. Please feel free to submit questions throughout the presentation, and we will try to answer many of those at the end. You click on the question mark to submit your questions. It's often in the upper left corner of your screen, but it may be somewhere else on your screen. I'm going to go ahead now and hand it over to Dave Eckert. He's the program chair for the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club, going to tell us more about the series co-sponsors, and our fantastic presenter. Dave, go ahead and take it over.
Okay, let's see. Let me bring this up, share screen, and on the beginning. Okay. Oh, yeah, let me go back up. Okay, you can see it. Welcome, and thank you for coming, and thank you, Bonnie. Bonnie is such a joy to work with at the library. So tonight, I keep changing titles on these just to keep you awake. It's called Growing Wetlands, and we have three of them, Finley Wildlife, Herbert Farm, and the Owens Jackson Fraser Complex. And like Bonnie said, we honor Liz and Bob Frenkel with this for all their work on the environment, and not only locally, but in the state and on the whole national wildlife and refuge areas. Their work is unsung and broad and deep, and we're very grateful for the work that they left behind for all of us. And we're honoring the Empinafu Kalapuya. We in Corvallis live in Champinafu, and that is the area of the Mary's River watershed. And we honor not only land of Champinafu, we honor the Empinafu Kalapuya. And unfortunately, as most of you know, they were marched and confined in a encampment for 5 months in Corvallis before they were shipped and marched up to the Grand Ronde. That is something we need to come to grips with here in Corvallis. And the Kalapuya culture is alive and well, not only in the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde and in the Confederated Tribes of Siletz Indians, but other Kalapuya living throughout all of the tribally ceded land. And we've been working with them to look at ways to work together and build relationships. This is all co-sponsored by the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club. And we inspire a culture engaged with flora and fauna, soil and water, and geological features. And we're very honored to be able to co-present this with the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. We do the spring series, and we do a fall series called Champinafu Lecture Series or Webinar Series. And from some of these, we've come up with some programs that you can now watch at your leisure afterwards. We did a very short video, 9-minute video called Damned Oak Creek, which you go on YouTube and just type in Damned Oak Creek. And I recommend you watch that. It'll show you the difference between why there are problems with human-made dams, but why beaver dams are so important to our lives and to the health of the earth. And it's very relevant to these programs we're going to see this spring on wetlands, as you can see below. 2 years ago, we did what we call the gift series, which we did one wetland, Jackson Fraser Wetland and Mary's Peak, and then Bald Hill Natural Area, because the Frankels, when they passed away, left a substantial amount of money for our the regeneration, reviving, and growing of those three specific entities. And we talked about those, and you can go on YouTube, just type in a gift for Jackson Fraser Wetland, or a gift for Mary's Peak, or a gift for Bald Hill Natural Area, and you'll be able to watch those webinars. They're pretty interesting. Last year, we did a webinar series, three-part series called Bevalis, and you can go on YouTube and type in Bevalis, and there'll be three of them. The first two were more locally focused or state-focused, and the third one was more globally focused. And so wherever your interests are, locally or state or globally, you can see those up in the ramped up. They're on the library's YouTube channel, but you just have to type in those words and that take you directly to it also. For those who we sold out in all the Bevalis shirts we had last year, but so many people have been contacting us. We're thinking of ordering them again. If you want to order one, they're organic cotton t-shirts with a special beaver woodcut on it in Bevalis, Oregon. And we use that to help regenerate wetland areas here in Corvallis. You can contact me at my email. We don't have them. Wait until we get a certain number of orders. They're $20 a piece. And so if you email me with your size, unisex size, and that you're interested, don't send any money yet. I'm just gathering names at this point. I want to show you again a picture that will entice you for each of the next two seminars or webinars that Bonnie already mentioned. We're talking about regenerating Herbert Farm Natural Area, places south of Corvallis that many people have not been to, and it's in a earlier stage of regeneration than Finley, but it is still spectacular, and very few people are aware of it and have actually seen it even recently. And then the third one is the Owens Jackson Fraser Wetland complex. It's not just Jackson Fraser. It's now a new area that is being added to this, and there are four land ownerships involved, and it's quite interesting to see this. And very few people know what's going on. It's in the early planning stages, so I highly recommend you also see this one. As Bonnie said, for the question and answers today, make sure you use the Q&A. Please don't use the chat. Use the Q&A, and you can enter your questions throughout. And then when our speaker is done, then Bonnie will read the questions to the speaker, and he'll be happy to provide answers. Now I'd like to present and pronounce Jared Jebusek. Right? And talking about regenerating the Finley National Wildlife Refuge. Now, Jared works for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. He's a biologist in the Partners for Fish and Wildlife Program at the Willamette Valley National Wildlife Refuge Complex. And his office is located at the William L. Finley National Wildlife Refuge, which is 10 miles south of Corvallis. And he spent the last 20 years helping private landowners and non-federal agencies and NGOs do voluntary wetland restorations throughout the Willamette Valley, including the wetlands I talked about that are going to be in the future webinars. And he's worked a lot with the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde on their properties and all around. But Jared has also done a lot of work in his career at Finley directly. And he is the best person to give this presentation tonight, and we are very honored to have him. Jared, take it away.
Thanks for the nice introduction, Dave. I'm gonna see if I can share my screen here. Okay, I'm hoping that this, can anybody confirm that they're looking at my slideshow?
Looks
good job,
great.
It's on.
Okay, great, thank you. As Dave said, I work at Finley. It's about 10 miles south of Corvallis. For those of you who don't know me, my other alias seems to be Molly Monroe's husband. For those of you who maybe work or live in different circles than I do. So I've kind of put like three different presentations together here. So I might be a little bit discombobulated as we go through, but I will try to get this done as best I can. We've got a lot to cover, so let's get started. I'm gonna get into a lot of nuts and bolts, a little bit on like ecological values and whatnot, but I wanna get into a lot of the nuts and bolts of the actual restoration work. But there's just a lot to cover, so I won't be surprised if there's quite a few questions towards the end. Before we get too much further, I'd like to talk about the Fish and Wildlife Service and make sure there's no confusion about anything. We administer the Migratory Bird Treaty Act for the United States. It also includes Canada and Mexico. The Endangered Species Act and the National Wildlife Refuge System. We are not the state. So if you have issues with E.E. Wilson or frustrated that you didn't draw the big game tag that you want, or you're upset about wildlife damage, talk to Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. Animal rehab, please don't call us, call Shintimini. Thank you. Oh, and that's a picture of a Fender's blue butterfly, of course. So jump to Finley real quick. Finley, as well as the other two refuges, Basket Slough and Ankeny, were established in 1964, mainly for the dusky Canada goose. It's a subspecies that winters in the Willamette Valley and breeds on the Copper River Delta. It's about 5,300 acres and includes Snagboat Bend, which is over along the Willamette near Peoria. I mentioned before that Basket Slough and Ankeny are in the complex. We do a variety of public use activities like the auto tour route, a bunch of trails. There's a store. We do interpretation and education activities, and there is some hunting allowed. It is a refuge. Being a refuge, it's wildlife first. No pets, no jogging, no camping, no weddings, please. So if you're interested in visiting Finley, here's the website that would be good to check out. There's trail descriptions, bird lists, list of events, and you can pick up the trail map on that, as well as you can find them in a lot of kiosks where we should have trail brochures. There's also a Friends of the Willamette Valley group that you could check out and think about joining. And there's a Photographers of Finley Facebook page if you want to see some of what people are seeing out there. This group is pretty hardcore out there all the time, getting some really good photos. So that might be something to keep an eye on. And then this is going to be the last weekend of Winter Wildlife Field Days. So you might want to check that out. Quite a few activities, a lot of them are geared towards children. So let's jump into wetlands themselves. What is a wetland? Sometimes you know it when you see it, and sometimes you don't. If I was a consultant doing a wetland delineation for some legal need, like I'm going to pave over a wetland with a parking lot or something like that, I would have to look at three things, which are saturation and inundation during at least part of the growing season. And the vegetation, there's some plants that are wetland obligates, and then there's some that can live in both wetlands and uplands. This is a female rufous hummingbird who is helping seed cattails, which are wetland obligate species. And then there's iron oxidation going on in the soil. Who wants a chemistry lesson? Not me, let's move on. So I think there's some ecological values common to all wetlands. Water filtration, groundwater retention, groundwater recharge, and fish and wildlife habitat are pretty much all kinds of wetlands do those things. Some of them are also pretty good at equipment retention if you're not careful, like whoever it was driving the backhoe, that it's not me. Let's start with farmed wetlands. On the left, you'll see a farmed wetland. It's got a puddle in the low spot, and those are greater yellowlegs, a type of sandpiper using it. Over on the right, you'll see an annual ryegrass field that is a wetland. Geese are using it. This is what most wetlands, most historic wetlands in the Willamette Valley are doing. We have lots of annual ryegrass and lots of geese. So I'll let you all do the math on that. NRCS created some soil maps for the entire Willamette Valley quite a while back, and they are actually pretty darn good. On the right, you can see a map of the whole Willamette Valley and kind of get an idea of where a lot of the wetland soils, NRCS calls them hydric soils, are. On the left, you'll see the Corvallis urban growth boundary. That block at the bottom is the airport. And then you'll see Finley. And so just think, when you're driving south to Finley, on both sides of the road for a lot of that, you're looking at farmed wetlands. The farmed wetlands are mostly being drained by ditching. Creeks have been channelized and tiles. The amount of tiling going on right now is just staggering. Thousands of miles of this stuff is going in the ground every year. Especially with the huge increase in the filbert industry. So let's move on to forested wetlands. This is at Finley on the south side of Bruce Road. And I like this picture because the ash trees have started to yellow up, but the oak trees haven't. And the oak trees are mostly right along the creek. So oak trees can tolerate quite a bit of water, and you find them more often than you might think in riparian forests. The Nature Conservancy did a bunch of habitat modeling for the Willamette Valley. On the left is what they think we had for riparian forests before European settlement. In 2008, the state or Oregon State or somebody did an analysis to look at what it is now. Down where Finley is, and I'm hoping people can see my cursor right now because I'm going to use it a little bit to point stuff out. Anyhow, things haven't changed too much at Finley. We have a pretty good riparian forest there. Here it is a little bit closer. Unfortunately, I forgot to put the Finley boundary on this map, but you can at least get an eye. Finley's right in there if you can see my cursor. So on Finley itself, we'll try to do a real quick orientation here. The star on the leftmost part of the map is where the office is. There's another star here, which is the viewing blind at the end of the Homer Campbell Trail. The star kind of on the northeast part is what we call the prairie overlook when you first come into the refuge from 99. And then down in the southeast part is the parking lot at McFadden's Marsh that goes out to a viewing blind there. And that's basically the first thing you come to as you come in off of 99 on Bruce Road. So the trails are in red. I'm sorry, they're not showing up quite as good for me as they did when I was fooling around with this on GIS. Anyhow, you can see the riparian forest is in kind of outlined in blue, and it pretty much goes through the center of the refuge, south to north. And then there's a little bit coming in from the west and Gray Creek. So it supports a bunch of different wildlife, particularly the neotropical migrant songbirds, but also red-legged frogs. The fluvial cutthroat trout live in Muddy Creek itself, but when things are flooded up, they spend most of their time out in the forest in really shallow water. And that's when they do most of their feeding and most of their growing. So it's really important to have good habitat in the locations where it floods. And then there's a wood duck, which should be in a tree cavity, but since there's not many around, we've put up a bunch of artificial cavities and they use them very readily. So a lot of this habitat has been lost around the valley. That is probably supposed to be a riparian forest, and you can see what it's doing now. So regeneration. I guess I would say planting is the easy part. Planting plans, I'm going to leave that up to other people to decide. It's probably a little bit of a blank slate for folks. So do whatever you want. You can do groves, you can of certain species, you can do rows, you can do thickets, whatever makes the most sense to you and whatever species make the most sense. I would caution you a little bit on Oregon ash. Maybe don't go too heavy on that because the ash borer may be a huge game changer for us. So think about some other species like white alder and Pacific willow maybe. So first, once you get the planting done, think about what your desired future condition is going to be for that, what you want your forest to look like. Second, you got to focus on survival of the trees themselves. And the first summer and second summer can be really hard on trees. And so talk about watering them, talk about mulching them. What we've found works best, especially with large numbers of trees, is to deal with the competition. And this photo illustrates some of that. Some spraying has been done around each tree to kill all the vegetation around it that would be competing for moisture. This gets done all over the valley when hundreds of thousands of trees are going in per year. Once you get them past those first couple of years when they're developing roots, then you're addressing threats like blackberries and stuff growing over them. So it's important to keep things mowed still and deal with any invasive species you might think could hurt the trees while they're still pretty short. And then what you're trying to do is get them to the what we call free to grow stage, where you could walk away from it and the trees are going to survive, but they need to be at least head high before that happens. So you got to do the maintenance before that, before you get to the free to grow stage. Sometimes the tree protectors help with large numbers of trees, usually don't do them, just go for numbers and overwhelm the grazers that might bother them. Those kind, the kind that you see in the picture are pretty good, but it's just a pain sometimes to have to go back and pick them all up. But if you've got beavers or deer or something like that, there's going to be some mortality, just expect it. So let's move on to marshes, ponds, and sloughs. Those are all terms for what I think are very different things. A slough, I really think of as something being created by geomorphology of a river. So usually it's going to be old channels or old side channels that might get cut off. And this is over at Snagboat Bend along the Willamette, and the Willamette's pretty dynamic and moves stuff around. So you find a lot of sloughs along some of the larger river systems that are more apt to move around. Here's an oxbow, which is a slough. Greenbelt Land Trust owns this piece. It's kind of between Corvallis and Albany. Critters you might expect to find there are Western pond turtles. I put a picture of an impressive Chinook salmon, but it's really the juvenile Chinook that utilize off-river habitats for rearing. And then wood ducks are always a crowd pleaser. And then that little minnow there is the Oregon chub, which used off-channel habitats throughout the Willamette Valley. It was a Willamette Valley endemic. So regeneration, mostly we end up back in the hydrology aspect of things, letting the water go where it wants to go, letting it go where it used to go. Hopefully allowing for aquatic species passage. A lot of work is being put into that to put in the right size culverts, right shaped culverts, countersink them so that aquatic species can get through. Most of the large wood has been removed from rivers and streams, as well as the sloughs and ponds and whatnot. So if we do a fair bit of deforestation to save oak trees, and if we have any available, we will put the logs in the creek or in the slough in this case. So let's move on to ponds. Usually they have permanent water and benefit a variety of critters. I put the red-legged frog here again, as well as a handful of Oregon chub. The Oregon chub was a endangered species until not too long ago. and through the efforts of restoration of off-channel habitats, as well as pond creation or getting rid of non-native fish from ponds and introducing these into environments safe from non-native fish like bass, we were actually able to meet delisting criteria, and it's the first fish that's ever been delisted from the Endangered Species Act through recovery rather than extinction. So Willamette Valley, that's a pretty special achievement for us. Let's move on to marshes. Usually they are more seasonal in nature and have a heavy herbaceous component to them. Their disturbance regime, another dynamic habitat, is usually flooding, and beaver tend to move water around. I should say beaver were also instrumental in pond creation. Again, it was all dynamic. A flood might fill in a pond and the beavers might build another one upstream, downstream, or in a new channel, and things were moving around everywhere all the time. So on Finley, again, hopefully you can see the spots I indicated there and are somewhat oriented. We've got some ponds, which are mostly towards the west side where the land gets a little steeper. This big one in the middle is Cabell Marsh. Again, the Homer Campbell boardwalk trail goes out to the viewing blind that overlooks that one. People are probably very familiar with McFadden's Marsh. This is north and middle and south McFadden's Marsh over here, very visible in the wintertime, especially lots of waterfowl roost there. Great place to see swans up close. There is a trail that goes along the west side of that. And so you're basically walking between the marsh and that Muddy Creek riparian zone. Now these trails, a lot of these trails are closed between Halloween and April Fool's Day. And then after April Fool's Day until Halloween, it's open and you can walk anywhere you want on the refuge. So for now it's closed, but it won't be long before it's open and you can walk this trail. There's another trail on the other side around that marsh that goes up and connects to an interior road that takes you past Cabell Marsh. If you've got friends and can take two rigs, drop one off here by McFadden's Marsh and hike all the way through, all the way up to the next parking lot up here, over here, over here. Really lots of things you can do and see out there. So this is a look at north and south McFadden's Marsh. Again, what looks like a road here is actually the railroad track. That's the east boundary of Finley. This is Bruce Road coming in from 99. That's a parking area and a viewing blind here, but there's also a little parking spot here and you can walk all the way along both of these marshes. You can't see a lot of the surface water at whatever date Molly took this picture on. And go in and then come out here through the prairie. You can see a couple of burns that we did on the prairie all the way to the north into the refuge. Here are three ponds around the office area, really easily viewable. Duskies hang out in this pond kind of between the barn and the office. But this one over here, this is the parking area on the upper part of the photo for Mill Hill Loop Trail, which is open year round, that overlooks this pond. We call it Display Pond, but this is one of those ponds that has the Oregon chub in it. So that's the office. The store is there as well. Stop in and check it out when you get a chance. So regeneration of marshes. Beavers are pretty good at it, but they don't always work real well with things like infrastructure and farmland. But there are some ways to live with them. On the left, you'll see a pond leveler. The idea is that that pipe extends out far enough into the wetland that the beavers can't tell that they need to work there instead of on the dam itself. And so you can basically keep the pond at the level you want. Also, another thing that's gotten pretty popular in the last 5 years is doing beaver dam analogs, where you drive a bunch of really thick stakes in the ground and pile a bunch of stuff on them, and it starts to act like a beaver dam. Also, sometimes the beavers just start using it as a dam, but usually not. Usually they go up a little or down a little just to show you that you built it in the wrong spot. I just try not to question them because they know a lot more than I do. So more on regeneration, you got to fix the hydrology. And the tiles that went in the ground, you've got to get those out. In this case, it was an old terracotta tile. So you can just smash those up pretty easily. So we're using a backhoe there to dig all that out, and it's time consuming and diesel consuming. And then we do a fair bit of grading, creating berms and excavating stuff. This is our scraper. It's our 60,000 pound beaver, creating dams and whatnot. And it's been very useful. So now let's move on to wet prairie. So you probably remember seeing that that map I had of all the hydric soil in the Willamette Valley. Hard to imagine a 1.5 million acres of this in the Willamette Valley. I guess early explorers looked out across the valley in the spring and thought they were looking at water. There was so much camas out there. So this is at Finley. It's what we refer to as a bunch grass forb matrix. And so there's some native grasses as well as sedges and rushes, but they're bunch grasses. And in the interstitial spaces, we've got wildflowers. In this case, we've got Willamette Valley bittercress. That's the little white mustard. And of course, camas. And then that might be plantain buttercup. If not, it's western buttercup. So this is what we would like to restore. But it is this is on a remnant prairie. There are lots of other plants out there. Plant diversity is really important. There were at least 100 species of plants in these prairies once upon a time, but not anymore. Here's a couple of the more interesting ones. On the left is an annual called the tricolored monkey flower. On the right is the peacock larkspur, which the largest population of that by far is at Finley. So come check that out here in May, late May, probably early June. And then start talking about birds, especially grassland birds. The western meadowlark is kind of that's one we're really after when we're restoring prairies. If we can get western meadowlark, that is like the stamp of approval that we have accomplished something. Other grassland birds, there's a short-eared owl, which mainly only winter in the valley, but on a prairie restoration we've been working on over in Linn County. We actually found them nesting there a few years ago, so we're super excited that about that. Another thing we have in prairies is vernal pools. That's a cinnamon teal using a vernal pool, and that is another crowd pleaser, I assure you. So again, the TNC modeling kind of shows where we think the wet prairie was historically, and it's pretty much gone now. And as a result, there's a few species that have gotten listed. Nelson's checker mallow on the left and Bradshaw's desert parsley on the right. We actually got another win for the Endangered Species Act. Bradshaw's desert parsley was delisted last year, fully recovered. And the Nelson's checker mallow is currently being reviewed in our headquarters before it hits the Federal Register to be delisted as well. So a lot of these prairie restorations are doing a lot of good stuff for rare plants. So some other wins for us. We're pretty excited about it. Prairies are pretty much gone, unfortunately. The hydrology is gone. The plant community is gone, especially. The disturbance regime is gone, which was mainly fire. And what little we have left is turning into woody, wants to turn into woody habitats or be invaded by invasive species. So we've done a lot, but we have a long way to go, so we better get to work. Sometimes it's hard to not want to get to work maybe a little bit too soon in the season. You'll notice there's not a driver in that seat because the driver is me taking the picture. And it actually, fortunately, we didn't need that tractor for a while because it took us a while to get it out. This is actually a Taiyi winery. Definitely a wetland. Here we are digging up some more tile. Same with the ponds and marshes. We got to get the hydrology back. You can see how deep we had to go on the tile. Looks like, I don't know, I guess Nate Richardson's pushing 6 feet tall, and it's almost up to his shoulders there, so pretty deep. And then we break out the scraper again and construct vernal pools, fill ditches, whatever we can do to get the water to sit up on top of the ground during the growing season. Here's an example of a vernal pool not too long after we restored it. So it's, you know, maybe ankle deep, and you get species like popcorn flower growing in it. So we try to restore quite a few vernal pools. They're usually dry up in, you know, by the beginning of June or something like that. So these hard packed clay soils can be kind of tough on machinery, even in the summertime, because they bake hard in the summer. I mean, it just, the ground gets really hard and cracked on the top. Anyhow, I think we were replacing the hydraulic motor on the elevator for the scraper. So we're always breaking something. We do a fair bit of working the ground to prepare the seed bed. And we do use herbicides. It's probably our least favorite aspect of the job, but it's an extremely useful tool, especially in the Willamette Valley. We don't have a freeze up, so we've got like a 365-day growing season, especially for some of the plants that give us the hardest time, like non-native pasture grasses. We have really productive soil. We have moisture during the growing season, and the Willamette Valley just grows stuff, and you have to be ready to fight the bad stuff to get ready to put in the good stuff. On the right, we've got a crew of guys spraying thistle and dandelion amongst native species to try to keep it from, try to keep the weeds from being an issue. Being nice to our neighbors is something that we take pretty seriously, and they notice very quickly if there are weed issues. And so we do what we can to stay in good stead with the rest of our constituency. Once we've got the seed bed prepared, we get out the tractor and the no-till drill. You can see the rows of grasses on the right. In this case, we put in the native bunch grasses first. Sometimes we do forbs first, and then we have to come back and interseed. But everything's grown up, so there's a lot of residue on the ground, and it makes it tough even for the no-till drill to get the seed into the ground. So, fire, and we do really like to burn when we can. If I was allowed to dress like that, that would be a great way to do it. All right, I'll move on from that photo. Here's an actual fire photo. It's been really rewarding and really important that we're able to use this tool. All these prairie species are fire adapted, and you know, this is the way the valley was managed for thousands of years, and we're doing what we can to try to get back to the smart way of doing things, so to speak. But fire's always got its own set of challenges. So after the fire, it's much easier to get out there with the no-till drill and get the forbs in. We also have a drill that goes on the back of a four-wheeler. There is Molly again, doing some restoration at Finley. Sometimes we try to do spring burns, and I was not driving the fire truck this time, but the fire trucks get stuck as well. So somebody had the idea to drive a pumper out there rather than stick with the Type 6 engine, and there it sat for a while. So here's a forb planting first. It looks like mostly dense spike primrose, which is it's in the fireweed family. On the right, you can see the drill, the lid to the hopper is open on the seed drill, and that seed right there is about $160 a pound, and it's got three dozen species in it. We'd like to get about 6 or 8 pounds per acre in the ground. So $160 a pound, 8 pounds, 100 acres, it adds up really fast. We also do some plug planting. There's some species that it's hard to get a hold of seed for, especially like species like this. Oregon geranium is a great example. It doesn't produce lots of seed, and right when you think it might be ready, you look and it's shot its seed all over because it's they're attached to little catapults. Sometimes we get lucky and find a prairie remnant and then try to restore that. On the left is me at Jackson Fraser Wetland in 2004 with a skid steer mowing wild rose to try to knock that out so the grasses and flowers could come out. And they did. Sorry, I don't have the after photo, but it looked pretty nice. So the idea is if we can get the brush knocked back and the trees out, then we could eventually get it to where we could safely burn the habitat. And that's mostly what we're after. One thing, it's nice to use a skid steer with tracks because sometimes if you try to do it with a rubber tracked piece of equipment, you're gonna puncture a tire like I did here. Here's an example of, this is North Prairie Overlook at the north end of Finley, the road looking straight down the road. That road was solid non-native pasture grasses. And then one winter, we decided to go out and spray those grasses out to try to get it ready for Bradshaw's desert parsley seeding. And the camas just came out of nowhere. We had no idea it was there. So sometimes a shot of herbicide can do wonders. So back to Finley, the area outlined in orange are our prairies. The big one you see there is, I don't know, that might be about 500 acres, but about 400 acres of that is a prairie remnant that escaped the plow. And it's the largest remnant that was never plowed on the valley floor, that of wet prairie that was never plowed. So it's a really special piece of ground, so special that we try not to even drive on it. All we do is burn it, and that's it, because that's how it was measured, how it was managed forever before that. So that's how we're trying to do it. Again, you can come in out of the north from the prairie overlook or out of the south and look around. We've got it split up where we try to get a third of it burned a year. So if you can figure out where that is, that's where the best wildflower show is going to be in the spring. Here's a burn on the central part of it. You can see we kind of toasted up some ash trees there, but they all come right back in the spring. There's an empty slide. I don't know how I did that. So then we're about done, I promise. Looks like it's about 8 o'clock. I work in the partners program, and so I'm fortunate enough to get to work off of the refuge with some really great partners and landowners. Between Finley and Corvallis, we work with Tai Winery. You'll see the sign on the left with the Savannah Sparrow on it says conservation easement boundary. They sold a conservation easement to NRCS to protect those wetlands, and we've been helping with the restoration there for quite a long time. You can, when the tasting room is open, there's trails you can walk there. So not a bad spot to go have a glass and take a stroll. There's two little properties down right on the north edge of Finley that are also in protection with NRCS, and we've been working on those as well. So when you're driving in, the road actually goes between those, so you can see what a restored prairie looks like. Then going north, Herbert Farm, we helped out quite a bit there, and then Mary's River Natural Area, and we've worked quite a bit at Jackson Fraser Wetland recently as well. Here's just a smattering of some of the partners we work with. Oops. So that is going to be the end. Looks like it's about 8 o'clock. So people were getting ready to give me the boot here anyway. So I guess it's maybe time to think about some questions.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much, Jared. That was really interesting. We have a lot of questions already. A question that came up, it seems like some people were confused about what tiling actually is, or if you can tell us just a little bit more about that. Not everyone understood that.
So basically you take about a 4-inch pipe, stick it in the ground. It's something that, it's a pipe that allows water to get in. It used to be in like a terracotta tile that was used, and now it's corrugated plastic with little holes in it, about the size of a dime or a nickel. Anyhow, it's supposed to let the water in, but not the dirt. And the water goes in and it flows out. So they're working really hard to get the water table about 3 to 5 feet lower than it would be, so it doesn't drown the root zone of whatever crops they're trying to grow.
Gotcha, thanks for that explanation. And then a few people also asked, how do you locate the buried tile, or how do you know where the tile is?
Well, sometimes it's evident when you're just out looking at the ground, you'll see a line of grass that's greener. And then you might see like 20 lines evenly spaced all across a field that are a little bit greener. Sometimes it is not evident at all. Sometimes maps were created when they were put in. And that's really helpful to know how many there were and approximately where. And then sometimes we have no idea and we have to get out the backhoe and dig a trench from one end to the other and see how many tiles we fracture on the way, and then where we cross them, just chase them up slope or down slope.
Wow. And then, and Steve asks, have the old tiles been installed at the depths you noted, 4 feet plus, or has soil accumulated over time?
It depends on the field you're in. A lot of the grass seed fields may have been tiled quite a long time ago. And then over time have been leveled by farming practices or on purpose with laser guided blades. So sometimes they're, you might dig down only a few feet and hit them. Sometimes you're still finding them 5 feet deep. The main thing is they have to have an even slope downhill. So they might be a few feet deep, and then, the ground is level for a ways, but then has to be even lower after that. So, it might end up being just a few feet deep at the end, but then in the middle might be 5 feet deep. So again, the ground not falling at an even slope, but the tile having to fall at an even slope. If that answers the question.
No, I think it does. There are a lot of questions about tile and tiling. And so I'll throw out one more and we'll move to something else. But someone else asked, can you fill the drain tile with some type of expanding foam to make it unusable rather than having to dig it up?
Yeah, you can. I've seen people do that. A lot of the time we don't dig up. Sometimes we do, but a lot of the time we don't dig up the entire tile. We might break up or pull up like, a 15 or 20 foot section and then go uphill a couple hundred feet and do it again and do it again and do it again. So it might be more tile disabling rather than digging up the entire thing. We haven't used that method just so we don't have to worry about stuff being in the ground henceforth, but I've seen people do that just to save some time and diesel.
Sure, thanks. And then there were some questions around herbicides. Like, for example, like Lee asks, what kind of spray is safest for humans, animals, and water for newly planted trees specifically?
Well, I guess as far as safety, it's always going to depend more on the application than maybe the chemical itself. A lot of the chemicals that get sprayed around the trees would kill the trees if it touched them. So you just, there's techniques where, you know, you can put a shroud around the tree or some kind of shielding to get the spray on the grass and not on the tree. There are herbicides that only kill grass. There's like three different herbicides that that kill grass, but not trees and not flowers. So sometimes we actually spray this stuff right over flowers. We're actually even allowed to spray it over Fender's blue butterflies because it doesn't hurt them, just to get rid of those grasses because they're so competitive. So between application and herbicide, most of the time spraying around trees, it's usually a broad spectrum like glyphosate. But sometimes they use the grass only herbicides. So I don't know, kind of a long-winded answer, but.
No, I think that's really helpful. Is there any concern about herbicide runoff in the water from spraying and its impact on waterfowl?
No, there's rules about the herbicides we use, and we have to consult with a couple different agencies before we use them. We have to do pesticide use proposals, and those always get reviewed by our endangered species folks, and we have toxicologists who work in our Portland office. There's really no concerns about waterfowl. The biggest concerns are for aquatic organisms, mostly bugs and fish that might use gills. Any herbicide that has detrimental effects to any of those species, we have to stay back from the water, for instance. As far as runoff goes, you don't spray right before it rains. We're not allowed to have runoff. Most of these herbicides don't last long at all before they're either taken up by the plant or broken up. Sun and microorganisms dismantle the herbicides, so they really don't last very long. So as long as you don't apply right before a rainstorm or something, you'll be okay. And then there's herbicides that are safe to use in the water.
Great. Thank you. Elena asks, are there seeds available to help propagate some of the native wildflowers that you mentioned, like in one's own yard or property?
There are. We mostly buy our seed from a pretty big grower, but there's organizations you can reach out to, like the Institute for Applied Ecology or the Benton Soil and Water Conservation District. Folks like that have a pretty good handle on those types of things. So yeah, there are places to get seed, most definitely.
Thank you. And someone was curious, when do the camas bloom in Finley?
The best time to see camas is probably maybe last week of April to third week of May, maybe. it can have a little bit different phenology depending on temperature, soil temperature. You know, there might be places where it blooms earlier in the uplands and later in the wetlands, or earlier, you know, under where it's in riparian areas under trees. And there's two species of camas too, the common camas and the great camas. So there's a little bit of variety, but if you're between the last week of April and the third week of May, you're pretty likely to see it.
Thank you. And this is just a comment, but I think it's really nice, so I thought I would share it. And I agree. Kim says, the delisting successes are so fantastic to hear about. Glimmers of hope from such incredibly persistent hard work. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So I just thought I would share that because I think that's nice.
Yeah, it's been pretty nice for us. We've to get some wins under our belt because, you know, been working on it for a couple decades now, and to get to see something like this happen within my career is pretty neat. The other win that we just had, like I say, Nelson's Checker Mallow is under review right now, but also the golden paintbrush, which used to be extirpated from Oregon, is also under review for delisting. Most of its range is up in Washington. And then the Fender's blue butterfly itself has been downlisted from endangered to threatened. And near as I can tell, after doing some research and some other folks up in Portland, we can't find another butterfly that's had the needle moved like that. So another first to the Willamette Valley, first fish and first downlisting of a butterfly. So yeah, we're pretty excited. Just a lot of great partners, a lot of private landowners we've worked with, you know, Greenbelt Land Trust, the county, the city, and a lot of great landowners have just made my job pretty easy and pretty rewarding to get to do this with such a close-knit community.
That's great. Thank you. What is NRCS?
NRCS is the Natural Resources Conservation Service. They're in the USDA. Once upon a time, it was the Soil Conservation Service. They paid people to tile their land. And now they're actually paying people to untile some lands. So they have, they wield the farm bill dollars. So they have a lot more money than the Fish and Wildlife Service does for these wetland easements, as well as other programs like the Environmental Quality Incentives Program that is doing a lot of really good oak work up in the forests. And then the CREP program, Conservation Reserve Enhancement Program, for working along streams, expanding riparian vegetation.
Great, thank you. And Catherine asks, has any spring burning been done this year, and are there any plans to?
I'm trying to remember now. We usually have a spring burn each year. We put it on the refuge. I think it's been at Ankeny. It usually goes back and forth between Ankeny and Basket Slough, and it usually attracts lots of people or lots of other partners like ODF and Forest Service and folks like that, the Grand Ronde especially. I'm having a hard time thinking of a time where I didn't see the Grand Ronde out on one of our burns. They've just been a fabulous partner in a lot of these efforts, getting burns done on the refuge, off the refuge, and on their own lands. And so it's really been a valuable partner that we've been able to work with there.
Great, thank you. Are there particularly good organizations to send contributions to that are helping with restoration of wetlands in the Willamette Valley?
Oh gosh, I don't know where to start actually. I mean, you can't really go wrong with the Institute for Applied Ecology, Greenbelt Land Trust, Benton SWCD, the Sustainability Coalition is doing a lot of that. Mary's River Watershed Council. I don't know, Molly's within eyesight here. I don't know if she has anything else for me, but those are the main ones. There's Benton County especially is rife with do-gooders.
And Lisa says, I'm wondering what plans they have or are thinking about related to emerald ash borer on the refuge. I'm worried.
We are worried too. I don't know. We're expecting carnage. I think our regional office is working on some sort of response plan. I've never seen this happen up close, so I don't know if I'm imagining it top kills most of them and they try to resprout from the crown quite a bit. So we might have ash thickets for a while until they totally die. I don't know, but I think we're going to be investing a lot in Pacific willow and white alder are the ones that are coming to mind, but we need to not discount oaks. A few inches in elevation gain in a riparian forest and you'll get oak trees as well. But I think Pacific willows, because they will grow up into a tall tree. Schooler willow will too. And then white alder especially are what we're gonna wanna replace them with. But as far as saving them, I don't know. I really couldn't tell you.
Thank you. Kathy asks, what is your favorite bird at Finley? What is your favorite plant?
Wow. Favorite bird. I might have to think about it. The peregrine falcon is just always going to be one of my favorites because their athletic ability is just so impressive, having watched them hunt and actually gotten close to them when they hunt, or watching them fly by me on Greenberry Road when I'm driving the speed limit or however fast I think I was going. Pulling G-forces that would make fighter pilots pass out and turn their bodies into goo. That one's always going to be a favorite for me. I really enjoy watching northern pintail fly. Flocks of northern pintail, I think they're the most graceful duck that we have. But I don't know, the yellow-breasted chat is a pretty cool bird. So I tried to spread it across three different taxa of birds. As far as plants, there's some really, really neat plants out there. Probably my favorite is the Farewell to Spring, because it's a late bloomer like me, so I feel a certain kinship to it.
That's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. And Holly asks, over the years, it seems like the marshes are filling in and disappearing. Are there plans to stop this and keep them open?
Well, I guess I'd be a little bit interested in which marshes she might be referring to, but the thing about these marshes are that it should be a dynamic habitat. And so more so at Basket Slough and Ankeny in recent years, we've had to go in and basically reset them, so to speak. Once they dry up, drain them early, dry them up, go in and mow them, and then take that, the big eight-wheeled tractor you saw the picture of me driving, just take that in with the really big disc and just completely tear it up and reset it to a annual plant community. And then gradually that will turn to a perennial plant community. And if you left it long enough, I think you'd eventually end up with a lot of it being a woody plant community. So there's some places where we let it go and some places where we try to introduce those disturbance regimes ourselves. I'd like to burn them more, but it's really hard to burn them because the fire gets down in the roots of a lot of the plants that are in there, especially the most common one being the creeping spike rush. And then cattails too, the fire gets down in the roots and it smokes forever. And the fire isn't out till it stops smoking. So we hate to set fires and then spend a week mopping them up when we would prefer to be setting more fires out in the prairies.
Thank you. This question came up a few times, so I'll ask it. If you're cremated after you die, can you have your ashes spread in Finley?
If you come to the refuge office and ask us, the answer is no. And so
sure.
I'm going to say no. Like, being a refuge, not supposed to collect any plants, wildlife, or even rocks or minerals, or nobody's going to come after you if you get caught picking blackberries. But if we wanted to enforce it to the letter of the law. So if you decide you need to ask that question, the answer will be no.
That's what it looked like from the website, but I was asked so many times I thought I'd throw it out there. Someone was asking, how do you include pollinators during restorations?
Include them well. Certainly planting as many types of wildflowers as we possibly can is the best way to do that. If what we want to have is some species of plants blooming over the entire season. So there's pollen available, and so there's food available. I always like to say, and maybe I'm not entirely correct, but I like to say that native insects have native enzymes for digesting native plants. And so the more types of insects you get, or the more types of plants you get, the more types of insects you get over the entire year, and that really boosts bird populations. They got to have as many insects as possible. So they've done some mapping of meadowlark territories, and on the research natural area, that important prairie on Finley, there were meadowlark pairs using as little as 12 acres and able to make a living on that. Whereas, out in a low quality, piece of ground that only has a few wildflowers that the restoration isn't completely done. It might take them 50 acres to do. So, you know, the more wildflowers we get, the better it is for insect populations, including pollinators. I don't know if that, I kind of got way off on a tangent talking about birds there, but so I don't know if that quite answers the question, but having 3 to 4 dozen species of flowers in our seed mix is kind of our best shot at it. But there may be an aspect to that question that I'm missing.
To me, that seems to answer it to me. That makes a lot of sense. Mike observes that native flower species seem to be blooming earlier than in the past. Do you think that this is happening because of global warming or other factors?
Yeah, well, this year has been pretty interesting to watch. Everything's looking like it's been behind to me. At least for stuff in the yard and stuff around the office, phenology this year looks like it's behind. I would like to think this year's maybe getting back to normal, because a lot of the stuff that's just starting to bloom now, I've seen starting to bloom in February. So my guess would be climate change, because certainly some things have been blooming earlier. And I think this year having a cooler year kind of shows how important temperature actually is. So that sounds about right to me.
Thank you. Jacqueline says, you mentioned trying to control weeds at Finley to keep neighbors happy. Can you talk more about the reciprocity in your relationship with neighbors?
Well, mostly what I was thinking of was a lot of the private lands we work on. Again, that's where I spend most of my time. Around the refuge, they either like us or they hate us, it seems like. But in most cases, it's all farms around us, people trying to make a living off of crops and any weeds are unwelcome. And so the more weeds they see, the more they see conservation as a detriment to them. There are certainly some landowners who let a lot of weeds go that we kind of cringe when we see their thistles or something blowing onto the refuge. But for the most part, with our neighbors being in the ag community, folks are pretty good about weed control. I'm not sure if that answers the question or not.
I think so. Let's see. I think we probably have time for about one more. Let me try to pull one out of here. About this one. Okay. Any thoughts on how the large Willamette Valley floodplain piece remained intact? Was it seasonally grazed?
Yeah, it was definitely grazed. Okay. We know that, but I don't know if it was just too wet and nobody wanted to mess with it, and, you know, some other owner. A lot of the threat to conservation comes during generational succession, when it goes from one generation to the next, or one landowner to the next. And it might be that one landowner just grazed it forever and then they sell it to a landowner who just doesn't graze. And there were probably, you probably saw more of these remnants wink out over time as we've gotten away from grazing And so some of the best prairies and best oak savannas we have left in the Willamette Valley are places that have been responsibly grazed, but that land use seems to be going away more and more. So we've been working hard to work with folks who still practice animal husbandry.
That's great. Well, it is 8:30, so I think that's probably all we have time for tonight. Jared, I want to thank you so much for your time. This was really informative and really interesting, and it was great to see everyone here tonight.
Well, thanks. Yeah, it's been fun. Really appreciate you giving me a chance, especially first crack at folks, so I could warp their minds a little bit. hopefully the other two webinars go well. We've been, the Fish and Wildlife Service has been involved both at Herbert Farm and at Jackson Fraser, both in terms of technical assistance and having our equipment running out there as well. So we feel very fortunate again to have such great partners.
I want to thank you, Jared, and thank you, Bonnie, for both of you to putting on this show. It's been a real honor, and it's a pleasure, and it's very educational. Thank you so much.
I agree. Thank you all. Have a good night. Thanks for being with us. Take care. Bye.
Thanks, everybody. Bye.